Loving God, we thank you for this new day. We pray that you would grant us your peace with all that we carry into this space with us this morning. We pray that you would speak to us with your life-giving words. For the sake of your new humanity, we pray. Amen. All right, so great to see everybody at St. John's. It's good to be here. I love that in Sari's sermon last week, he referenced an inspiring comment from me in reference to me speaking to a female colleague. And that inspiring comment was me saying that I begin with saying I am part of the problem. And so I don't know if you were there last week, but whatever I say today, I want to begin saying that I am part of the problem. And just I'm glad that can be a source of inspiration and a starting point. In engaging this parable of the words of Jesus from the Gospel of Matthew, if you're anything like me, you experience a great deal of cognitive dissonance by this scene, which is not a true story, mind you. Parables are stories Jesus tells in order to provoke, confound, or shock his listeners into seeing a new reality or seeing life in a different light. And the setting here is a wedding banquet, which is the icon of close relationship, or the celebration of two people being bound together by law, or two families being tied together. In Jesus' day, this is not so much a romantic picture, it's more of a legal scenario in a wedding. And in this setting, which is supposed to be a scene of celebration nonetheless, we have intermingled many thorns of violence and an array of power dynamics, hence the cognitive dissonance that we feel. We have slaves, for one, which to modern ears is a disturbing cultural phenomenon of the first century Middle Eastern context. We have guests who refuse invitation to a wedding banquet. The slaughtering of animals, slaves being killed. We have an enraged king and troops then being sent to destroy the murderers, so vengeance also. Oh, and then the burning of their city. And then when the final option for guests, the street dwellers, those good and bad, made it into the banquet hall, we have this strange detail unique to Matthew of the king binding a man hand and foot and throwing him to outer darkness where there's weeping and gnashing of teeth because he does not have the right clothes on. Huh? What is going on here? The vulnerability and celebration of a wedding and ruthless violence. Cognitive dissonance, we feel. So let's start with the dissonance and not try to resolve it. Just let the dissonance be there. Maybe the dissonance is exactly what Jesus is trying to provoke. This is one strange wedding we see, although maybe it's not so different from some of the weddings in our own families that we've been to before. First, context. There's two layers of context here. There's the context of Jesus' life at the beginning of the first century, which we may hear about more often, like these years where we see Jesus' life and all the history going on in that time. And then there's also the context of Matthew's community from which he is writing some 80 or 90 years later after the time of the events. I hope that makes sense. So Matthew is inevitably projecting into this passage and onto Jesus his own psyche, his interests, his quirks and fears. He's speaking out of his own particular struggles and traumas of his community. And Matthew's community has just undergone a massive trauma, having had their temple destroyed in the year 70. They've been dumped on by the powers of the day, and they found themselves in exile. Whole life foundation disrupted and torn apart, and now a struggle for leadership. What beliefs and practices do we hold on to? What do we let go of? Life is changing, and how can we find some groundedness in a time of profound disorientation? Maybe we can all relate to this struggle right now in such a poignant way in the midst of this pandemic and so much more. So the first point I want to suggest this morning is that I would suggest that the intensity and violence and power dynamics we see in this parable is a reflection of the conflict and trauma that Matthew's community is experiencing. It's more validation than indictment. It's more of a mirror than a didactic. I hope that makes sense. This is reflecting Matthew's community and not so much trying to teach us something or give us a lesson out of this parable. Like Jesus is saying, this is what kings do when they don't get what they want, when they feel rejected and powerless. This is how they act out in rage. And implicit in the words of Jesus is a call to remember that this is a wedding party we're talking about. Remember, it is love that has called us forth into this great and tumultuous unknown that we find ourselves in. One part of my job as a priest over the years, and Sari will know all about this, is doing premarital counseling. And in premarital counseling, we often use this tool called Prepare Enrich, where each person in the relationship takes an inventory of questions, which generates a report, which is not a test to pass or fail, but it's an inventory which is meant to provide education to a couple about their relationship. It holds up a mirror and tells a story and hypothesis as to the satisfying parts of the relationship to affirm and strengthen, and as well as the areas of challenge and growth they want to give attention to, or at least to be in safe space with a witness to talk about the things they wouldn't otherwise. And in Prepare Enrich, there's a category called idealistic distortion. Idealistic distortion. It's something that only the facilitator sees. And idealistic distortion is a graph showing the degree to which one or both in the relationship sees the relationship through rose-colored glasses, where one or both is blinded by love and the fantasy that the other is everything they could possibly hope for in order to feel whole and complete. This is a common phenomenon in premarital space and probably in many relationships going forward as well. In all seriousness, I think we all struggle with some measure of idealistic distortion in relationships and in life in general. I know I find myself constantly looking for the ideal, something I imagine should be, and then bumping into the messy, imperfect real over and over again. Things just don't seem to work out as I imagine they would, and I have to cope with what is actually there. One ongoing realization I continue to reflect on, especially in relationships, is the constant pull and demand that I can put on another person to be a certain way or to behave accordingly or to think as I do so that I can feel okay and better about myself, right? Or the ways in which I need to put down or criticize another or someone on the other side of the aisle for me to feel okay. This is what we tend to do, where the love that we are able to give or not becomes very conditional. So a point and a thought I offer today is that this parable and parables in general are not necessarily prescriptive about who God is. Not like a pill or insight where clearly God must be the king figure in this story, as we might often just default to see. But these parables are descriptive about who we are and what we do. They are a mirror in an inventory telling a story about us. We are like the king who is hurt and traumatized because people didn't come to the wedding that we have prepared. And out of his own pain and rejection, his tendency to violence and exclusion came forth. And if God is to be located anywhere, perhaps it is in the presence of the very last guests, those from the streets, the outsiders, the marginalized, those good and bad, those who wouldn't miss this wedding banquet for the world. A spiritual writer, Richard Rohr, who I read often, says this. He says that if we do not transform our pain, we will most assuredly transmit it. If we do not transform our pain, we will most assuredly transmit it. And I wish this were not so true. We read about this violent wedding and we're provoked to ask, wait, is this us? Is there a better way? As we engage the story with our hearts, we can ask ourselves with imagination, where is love calling forth a different response from between and outside the lines of the story? Are you with me this morning? This parable can be a metaphor for what has happened in perceptions of religion today. The cognitive dissonance that we experience in reading this parable is maybe not so different from the dissonance that people in our culture experience in their perceptions of the church. Gandhi is famously quoted as saying, If it weren't for Christians, I would be a Christian. There are those who feel banished by the church and left in darkness for not having the right clothes on, for not having the right dogma or belief system, or those who have dared to have very real doubts. How does it change our way of thinking and operating when we see the world and ourselves through the lens of the outsider, whether socioeconomically outside, racially outside, or to be the outsider by sexual orientation or by the religiously disenfranchised? Similar to Matthew's context, if there's a common theme that binds us all together today, it's the theme of trauma. Like, wow, we have been through a lot in recent years, and in 2020 alone, holy cow, we are living through such a cauldron of trauma and figuring out how to cope with this changing world, whether the pandemic or wildfires in my neck of the woods in California, and perhaps a unique and unprecedented political scene and divisiveness, which is its own kind of wildfire. Any idealistic distortions we may have are being abruptly disrupted. And we know to our fear and anxiety that life could change without a moment's notice. And for some of us, it truly has in particular ways. And how do we cope? How can the sacred stories of Jesus make a difference if they're embodied and offered and pondered and wrestled with in loving spiritual community? I reread a piece recently by New York Times writer David Brooks called Tales of the Super Survivors. And he notes that findings of academic research into the effects of trauma recently have shifted in a more positive direction. Human beings are more resilient than we'd earlier thought. One psychologist, Philip Fisher, noted that the big background factor that nurtures resilience is unconditional love. Unconditional love. The people who survive and rebound from trauma frequently had an early caregiver who pumped unshakable love into them. And that built a rock of inner security they could stand on for the rest of their lives. And this part is especially provocative, I think. Recovering from trauma is mainly an exercise in storytelling. As Richard Tedeschi, another psychologist, has pointed out, trauma is a shock that ruptures the central story that you thought was your life. The sense of safety is lost. And having faced a notable challenge, people in these circumstances are forced to confront the elemental questions of life. But some people are able to write a new story. As he writes, post-traumatic growth comes not from the event, but from the struggle afterward to write a new story that imagines a life better than before. And researchers have found that people who thrive after a shock are able to tell clear, forward-looking stories about themselves, while those who don't thrive get stuck ruminating darkly about the past. I know I struggle all the time with just ruminating darkly about the past, and yet we're invited to tell these stories forward. And the stories of super survivors have two big themes They are optimism and altruism. Said another way, they are hope and acts of service, spurring one another on to good deeds and service in our local communities and our world. And this is two places where churches can really shine right now. There's so much more I could say this morning, yet the grace of parables is that they are unfinished stories. The next chapters are ours to dream and create together. Sometimes the story we see in our lives appears to be quite chaotic and out of control. But yet, as we hold fast to our faith and look closely enough, God sneaks in at unexpected times or unexpected ways through unexpected details. Hang in there, St. John's. God bless you. Thank you so much for having me today. Amen.